And we're in the US right now, at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, home of the Green Berets.
The American Army's Special Forces are dedicated to their motto, to free the oppressed. Upholding tradition and honor, they're the men of the Green Berets. Operation Desert Storm was a military victory for the United States and its allies. Tactics and technology combined to make Norman Schwarzkopf's men unbeatable. Special Forces or Green Beret commandos deserve credit for their role in the war against Saddam. They infiltrated deep into Iraq, becoming the eyes of the storm. They provided Central Command headquarters with Desert Truth, an accurate report on the status and location of Iraqi forces.
On the 6th of February, we were notified of our mission, put into isolation for approximately 2 to 3 weeks. And on the night of the 23rd of February, we were inserted behind enemy lines, approximately 147 miles. And we started our reporting via satellite communications.
Special Forces also trained coalition forces, working with soldiers from countries as diverse as Czechoslovakia and Saudi Arabia.
The Saudis were given the mission to get the Iraqis out of Saudi Arabia. And a lot of people had apprehension on exactly how that was going to happen. But, I mean, I was amazed when the order was given and the Saudis went up there with a lot of confidence, a lot of desire, and basically did exactly what they were supposed to do.
During the liberation of Kuwait, Special Forces were one of the first U.S. units to enter Kuwait City. Their mission, to secure the American embassy.
We were to infill the U.S. embassy and return it to sovereign ground. As being a U.S. service member in Special Forces, I felt very proud to be able to be on this mission.
While we were performing armed guard operations around the embassy there, once we went in, until the U.S. Marshals arrived, people were coming up to you, you know, again, shaking your hand and thanking you. And I acquired a couple of pictures of George Bush, which, of course, is a much sought-after item there. And so I gave one to two young ladies. And the next day they came back and they said, our father would be honored if you would come to our house tonight for dinner. And I said, well, I have to ask my chain of command. And I checked with them and they said it seemed to be pretty secure. Just took my weapon with me and I went there. They were very grateful. They laid out a very large supper on the floor and little children come up and sit on my lap and things. And upon leaving, she gave me this huge painted sheet which expressed her feelings from the time the Iraqis invaded Kuwait until the time they were liberated.
Special Forces were also instrumental in setting up and implementing Provide Comfort, a relief effort to shelter, clothe, and feed over 1 million Kurdish refugees.
We're talking 500,000 people, all very hungry, all very thirsty, and the water was running out, and the summer heat out there in that type of terrain would have just killed them.
No one can ever train for a mission like that. I mean, what do you serve 500,000 people for dinner? You just got to go in, you got to do an initial assessment, and you got to attack the mission. You got to go out and help those people. They say, this is what we accomplished. They give you these, you know, these parameters. I want this mission done. Then you get to decide how you want to do it, do the assessment, make it happen.
You won't hear us beating our chests, and you're not going to get a lot of credit for saving a lot of lives and provide comfort. But it just gives you a pretty big sense of self-satisfaction to be able to say, I accomplished something, I did that.
Special Forces, Green Beret,
Green Beret.
Lean and mean, rough and tough,
he can hang,
you can hang,
run with me,
to the sun,
every day.
The quality of the Special Forces soldier today and this breed that we've got now to go into the 21st century, particularly after Desert Storm, I'd match them with anybody. They might be a little short in some of the close camaraderie that we had in the old days when it was very, very small. But what I've seen from our units that fought over there, when they come back, just listen to them talk. There's a close association that I see connecting there, an American warfighter of the old as opposed to the day, and the same spirit as an American patriot or just a special forces soldier will go anywhere and do anything they want us to do.
More than anything else, the success of special forces is a story of courage, confidence, and maturity of some of the best trained soldiers in U.S. history.
National defense is serious business. The Army is serious business. The mission of the Army is to export violence. Pure and simple, Reader's Digest version of what the Army is supposed to do. And the very worst thing that a leader can do to a soldier is not train him. To send a soldier away untrained is like signing his death warrant. But I have seen, we have seen, people in my era have seen the Army completely reverse on that, and especially Special Forces. If he is well trained, we're going to see the same thing that happened to us in the Persian Gulf. The other guy's going to roll over because he can't stand it. Because our guys are well trained, and they're the best they've ever been.
World War II was the genesis of today's Special Forces. The first Special Service Force was nicknamed the Devil's Brigade by the Germans. Merrill's Marauders wreaked havoc in Burma. And there was General Wild Bill Donovan's OSS, or Office of Strategic Services. All played a key role and demonstrated the value of special operation forces in modern warfare. It wasn't until 1952 that special forces were initially activated at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Colonel Aaron Bank, the father of the Green Berets, was instrumental in developing this elite fighting force. The activation of the 10th Special Forces was performed without fanfare or publicity. The total group strength of the unit was 10 soldiers. That was soon to change. As a student of military affairs, President John F. Kennedy had developed an interest in counterinsurgency, the art and method of defeating guerrilla movements. After visiting the Special Forces at Fort Bragg in 1961, he realized that they were the men for this type of mission. As the Special Forces had special duties, the President felt they should have something to set them apart from other units. They were to wear green berets. Kennedy called it a symbol of excellence, a badge of courage, a mark of distinction in the fight for freedom. Nam Dong, Dok To, Lang Vey, just some of the places Special Forces troops fought and died during their 14-year stay in Vietnam. It was a stay that began in June 1956. Their responsibility was to train South Vietnamese soldiers in the art of counterinsurgency and to turn them into a credible anti-communist threat.
Muon Ban Chet Mo Ten Quan Di Kai Kak Ain Kala Chung Ba Cham Thut Thi Duot Voi Khẩu Sung Nai Nhưng Xa Hơn Thi Chắc Là Không Duot.
By the time the 5th Special Forces Group left Southeast Asia, its soldiers had earned 16 medals of honor, 90 distinguished service crosses, 814 silver stars, more than 13,000 bronze stars, 235 legions of merit, and 2,658 purple hearts. It was a brilliant record, built solely on blood and sacrifice. Back at home in America, a confused public searching for heroes in a strange and unfamiliar war quickly latched onto the Special Forces. John Wayne made a movie about them. Barry Sadler had a number one hit song called The Ballad of the Green Beret that sold 9 million copies. The Green Beret took its place alongside the Davy Crockett cap and the cowboy hat as one of America's mythic symbols.
For those oppressed, leaving her this last request, put silver wings on my son's chest, make him one of America's best. He'll be a man they'll test one day, have him win the Green Beret.
With a car as special as the new Mazda 323, we don't need to shout. If you'd like to know more, Please video this commercial.
Glass. Look, I've got a cracked windscreen.
A Rover 216. We'll send someone out to you.
I also need a screen for an 8-stage Cavalier, a 92 Mercedes 190, an 88 Volvo 74.
If you need glass for any car, any place, any time, Autoglass.
No problem, sir.
One call does it all.
Where would you start if you wanted to make a collection of the world's best rock tracks? Take bands like Rainbow, Deep Purple, Foreigner, Jethro Tull, Free, Black Sabbath, and Thin Lizzy. You'd take artists like Gary Moore, Brian May, and Alice Cooper.
Well, I'll take whatever I want.
You'd take 100 tracks from the 100 best albums of all time, and you'd cram them all on one CD set.
You're as cold as ice. Since you've been gone. Since you've been gone.
It's called rock. But it's only available from Sounds Direct by post. So get a pen ready.
I've been driving all night, man's wet on the wheel.
The ace is fake. The ace is fake.
Whoa, Black Betty, Bama Lamp.
This 6-CD or cassette set has over 6 hours worth of original tracks. Get your copy. Call now. Rock from Sounds Direct. Sounds you can't afford to miss.
For the American Army, Special Forces soldiers perform 5 primary missions: unconventional warfare, foreign internal defense, direct action, special reconnaissance, and counter-terrorism. This is Dodge City, the training area for Special Forces CQB, or close quarter battles. It's here that the Green Berets practice difficult room-to-room hostage rescue techniques using live fire.
This scenario today we're having, I'm letting them know there's at least one good guy inside. I'm calling him a down pilot, and they're going to shoot up the bad guys, ensuring they don't shoot the one known good guy that they have inside. There may be more. They don't know that. But basically, it's going to take very strict discipline on their part to accurately target discriminate and to shoot while moving.
Good to go, guys. It was a lot quicker. Second room went down a lot faster. How was the shot?
Saved him.
Good stuff.
The selection process for Special Forces is intense and demanding. Not just anyone can earn the Green Beret and Special Forces label. The difficult training allows the Special Forces an opportunity to assess each soldier by testing his physical, emotional, and mental stamina.
At no time in the entire process is there any coercion to complete the course. So the individual can volunteer out just as readily as he volunteered in. We suffer quite an attrition as a part of that process, but that's part of the bill that we have to pay.
Only one out of three soldiers makes it through the qualification course. Those that pass are now members of one of the Army's most distinguished units.
What we are interested in is quality and not quantity. We want the right man or we don't want any man. We would much rather have 100 people that we can trust, that we have absolute confidence in, than 500 or 1,000 people where we have some kind of a doubt.
The Green Berets are also the American Army's elite commando units. They're designed to infiltrate by land, sea, and air deep into enemy-occupied territory and organize a resistance with an emphasis on guerrilla warfare. Special forces are trained as force multipliers, capable of organizing and equipping a guerrilla force of up to 1,500 indigenous personnel.
We don't have any artillery. We don't have any tanks. Our prime way of doing business is to persuade somebody, to negotiate with somebody, to communicate with somebody, understand his side of the story. And this relies heavily on interpersonal skill. He has to be able to operate totally alone under extreme stress in hostile environments. And so you need somebody that's a little tougher than the average individual.
Perhaps the most familiar sight in the Special Forces community is the SEER school, which stands for Survive, Evade, Resist, Escape. Created by the late Colonel James Nick Rowe, who spent 5 years as a prisoner of war in Vietnam, the school trains soldiers to avoid capture, but if caught, to survive and return home with honor. This class is learning survival skills, specifically various ways to build a fire.
And there you go. And if you put your hand in there, it's very hot. You just simply stick it in there, get an arc between them. There we go.
The 3 weeks these soldiers spend out in the wild, living off the land, teaches them a lot.
You know, sometimes in a survival situation, it's the simple things that can either make your life a little bit easier or help you survive. In this situation here, when it starts raining, the water's going to come down this tree. Once it hits this string here, it's going to follow itself on down and inside the shelter that we've got, and making the evening pretty miserable for the gentleman here. A way to defeat that is to go ahead and use something as simple as another piece of wood, a stick. Just go ahead and take that and wrap it around, tie a knot into it. Once we get that in there, that defeats it because the water's going to come down, hit the and drip here.
Surviving and operating behind enemy lines is the way of life of Special Forces. 12-man A-teams function as complete tactical and self-sufficient units. Each soldier is cross-trained in 5 military specialities.
To my right is some of the equipment that we use for observation and surveillance in the intelligence portion of the job. We have some night vision goggles, night vision targeting scope, binoculars, general purpose camera. These are just a few of the items that we have available for the collection of intelligence. What we have here are some of the weapons that are found throughout the world and we must maintain our proficiency in. In the front, you have various assault rifles of the world. Here to my right, you have the various machine guns found throughout the world. In the center is an array of submachine guns and handguns. And to the right, the far right, is the sniper rifles most popularly used. What I have here is basically some of our commo gear. HF communications, our primary back to the higher, TACSAT with different modes we can employ it, CW, voice, and burst.
This is some of the equipment that we have available for dentistry, surgery, a water test kit to test for quality of water. We have an emergency dive medical kit to take care of any dive emergencies, and a trauma kit. We have to take care of all aspects of any medical care for the team.
This is some of my demolitions equipment that I may carry on a mission. To my far right is a spool of firing wire, various other equipment for constructing an electrically initiated explosive.
Meet William H. Rambo, a real-life sergeant major in the U.S. Special Forces.
When they hear that Rambo is coming, they have this
preconceived notion that this big, tough feller is going to come around, and it's just totally opposite.
Unlike Sylvester Stallone's portrayal of a snake-eating Green Beret in the popular Rambo movies, William Rambo is a quiet professional, a term used by many to describe today's special ops soldiers.
The quality of the soldiers in Special Forces today is head and shoulders above the soldiers when I first came in to Special Forces approximately 11 years ago. I think one of the reasons for the increase in the quality of the people is, number one, the intelligence level has increased, and secondly, the selection process that we're now going through to bring the soldiers into our force. We accept nothing less than the best. And for the most part, that's exactly what we have today.
Today, Special Forces soldier has a worldwide mission, and in many cases, he may be the only American military presence in a foreign country.
Nashi, where's Zoe? Nick?
Alada.
Danny?
Alada.
Language skills are as important to Special Forces as physical training. Every soldier receives 16 weeks of classroom work using the latest technology of voice recognition.
Managua.
Muy bien.
We're trying to get our people to a proficiency level that they're able to go into another country, speak and listen in the other language to a degree that they feel comfortable. Right now, today, I've got 35 different classes going on in 14 different languages and a total of 268 students. Over the next year, I should get up to having close to 400 students in residence at any one time. The Special Forces soldier comes to the Special Forces language course after he's finished the qualification course. And now, as part of his MOS qualification, all of them are required to speak a language before being considered fully MOS qualified and going to their unit.
The experiences that I've experienced over the years in several countries throughout the world have been more on nation building or on foreign internal defense missions. That is where we go into a host nation and we train their soldiers in the art of warfare. And that art of warfare is generally towards light infantry related tasks. And what we do with them is we bring them up to an acceptable level and we train hand in hand with those people.
So our Special Forces soldier is a mature individual. He's got great perseverance. We're really interested in the fact that he's got interpersonal skills. He can work not only with another human being of his own culture or his own society, but he can go to a foreign culture and a foreign society and work and survive. And then he has some language skills and then some ability of the local customs and mores, so he doesn't go in and make that social blunder that might turn a potential ally off.
I would say today that we probably have the best trained soldier we've ever had. We have commanders that understand the seriousness of it. We have non-commissioned officers that understand the seriousness of what a soldier is supposed to do. And we just saw in the Persian Gulf War what our well-trained soldiers can do, well-led soldiers can do, and we also saw once again that you can't win a war with negotiations. When it comes to the bottom line, there's going to have to be a confrontation, and there's going to be a soldier on the ground that does it.
Well, we're just another capability that gives our national command authority, our president, an ability to tailor a force for a specific requirement. And the future for Special Forces, I think, is very bright. And we'll probably spend a great deal of our effort in peacetime engagement, whether it's a disaster relief, whether it's training somebody, advising somebody, whether it's civic action, those kind of things, or whether it's something that's more hostile, like contingency operation, an insurgency, that we're someone helping out somebody to fight this kind of an insurgency. Our soldiers will be required to do that. And I think we're well prepared and we're training to that requirement. So I'm very optimistic about the future.
Every month, Special Forces are working in at least 20 different countries on 6 continents. They remain loyal to their Latin motto, De Oppresso Liber, to free the oppressed.
I love Army Special Forces. It's probably the greatest thing that's happened in my life. They taught me self-reliance, self-discipline, and gave me a can-do attitude to accomplish anything that they want accomplished.
As long as I can do things like this, you can probably have most of my paycheck.
It really is, I think, a noble profession. Number one, just to be serving our country in the armed forces.
It is without doubt the most challenging and the most rewarding job I've ever had, and it's just something most civilians can't just equate with. It's not just going and getting your money. It's just like a poster said. It's a commitment. It's a lifestyle, and it's something I always have and always pass on to other people.
The day that he graduates from that course and joins a team is probably the proudest moment of his life, he thinks, until he stays with that team a while and that team camaraderie gets him really into him and they go away on a real world mission, and then he really becomes proud. That's the most close-knit organization you'll ever find in your life. I thank God every day for having the opportunity to be involved with these soldiers every day, with this army. This army is the answer. Without an army, we wouldn't have a country.
Next today, the special force whose motto is Fidelity, Bravery, and Integrity, the FBI.